may surprise you to know that today and every day we produce enough food on this planet. We produce enough food every day to feed about 10.4 billion people. We only have 7.5 billion people on the planet. So we produce enough food to feed 3 billion more people than we have. But today, as we're sitting here, 800 million people will not eat today. They suffer from chronic malnutrition. And as many as 1.6 billion people live in a constant condition of food insecurity. So think of it, we're producing an awful lot of food, and that's important. It has been the engine of some incredible gains. Back in 1900, life expectancy worldwide was about 31. Today it's over 70. In some parts of the world, it's over 80. And that massive increase in life expectancy was driven by many factors, but two of the most important were improvements in sanitation and improvements in diet. Reliable access to nutritious food allowed people to live considerably longer. And yet we have a world in which we produce enough food for everybody, but still 800 million people don't eat on any given day. And while we're talking here today, 540 children under the age of 5 will die from malnutrition. 540 people will die as we're sitting here because they don't have enough food on a daily basis. Nonetheless, we manage to kill it. Each year we kill 51 billion animals to feed people. 51 billion animals to feed people, and yet we don't get this. So we have all sorts of problems with the system, and the problem isn't just that people who need food are not getting it. We also have taken over an awful lot of nature. We've displaced a lot of other forms of life that need to eat. And as a result of that, we've increased the rate of species extinction by at least 1,000-fold over what we think would be its natural rate. We've occupied so much land. While we're talking here today, just in the next hour and a half, a forest equivalent to 1.5 times the size of this campus, and this is one of the biggest campuses in the world, 1,474 acres, and forest equivalent to 1.5 times that will be cleared mainly for agricultural purposes. So people aren't getting the food they need. We're putting a lot of pressure on other species. We're putting a lot of pressure on nature. A lot of the ways in which we've chosen to produce food lead to massive amounts of fertilizers and so on going into our water systems, causing algae blooms, which are killing off large parts of the ocean, large parts of our marine life. You see massive amounts of soil erosion. You could look at the challenge of food. We eat well. In fact, we eat so well that 600 million people on the planet are obese, and 2.1 billion people on the planet are overweight. We produce lots of food, but we're doing it in ways which are not particularly fair and not particularly good for the environment. And so as we look forward, we see the pressure of climate change and the pressure of urbanization and the deepening of inequalities. We really need to think very carefully about food security in our food system. And so beginning tonight and for the next couple of days, we're going to focus on what the role of the University of California might be in addressing this challenge. And the University of California brings 250,000 of you each day of the year. 250,000 people like yourselves can be mobilized around this sort of issue. 20,000 faculty can be mobilized around this sort of issue. So we have a big role to play. And if we do something, it has impacts far beyond our local communities, far beyond the state of California, far beyond the country. It has global implications, what we do at in the UC system. I couldn't be more excited than to be here to introduce tonight's speaker, Dr. Marcia Ishii Eichmann, senior scientist and director of the Grassroots Science Program in the Pesticide Action Network, which is located up in Oakland, California. She's been there for the past 2 decades. Before that, she worked throughout Africa and parts of Asia on a number of projects. She developed women's health literacy and resource conservation programs. She developed farmer field schools in ecological pest management, sustainable agriculture, and community-based rural development. She has had considerable on-the-ground field experience in tough places, like the border of Somalia and Ethiopia and the Thai-Cambodian border. And she's also worked as a researcher, publishing an enormous amount in this area. She has a bachelor's degree from Yale University in Women's Studies, and she has a PhD in Ecology and Evolutionary Biology from Cornell. In addition to her policy work, her field work, her writing, she writes a blog on a variety of contemporarily important issues. She's here tonight to talk to us about one of the challenges that the food system faces that there may be a solution to. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ishi Aitman.
Thank you. Well, it's wonderful to be here tonight. Thank you all for coming out to this this gathering. We can reverse climate change and create vibrant rural communities, and all the while recovering and restoring the ecosystem functions that are critical to our children's children and future generations' ability to live happy, healthy lives. It will take an agroecological transformation of our food and farming systems to accomplish this, but it can be done. Our global food system is broken, and climate change is spinning out of control. As we heard, over 800 million people are hungry. That's 1 in 9 people on Earth. And people are hungry not because there isn't enough food in the world. As the World Food Program has told us, as we just heard, we produce more than enough food in the world to feed the world's population and more. So it's not because there isn't enough food. It's because people are poor and they can't afford food. And people can't afford food because the price of food is out of reach, and they can't afford healthy food, which is what they most need. Now, the price of food is not set by family farmers. It's more directly influenced by grain traders, governments, and global trade arrangements, for example, that allow industrialized countries of the North to export and dump their surplus cheap grain, and flooding those markets and driving farmers off the land. This combination of unstable markets and unfair trade arrangements, along with the critical problem of lack of secure access to land and water, is what is keeping farmers on the knife edge of survival. And now we add to this mix the reality of climate change. So we are seeing an increasing frequency and ferocity of hurricanes, cyclones, wildfires around the planet, an increasing drought and floods, and other extreme weather that is happening. We are also seeing changes in regular seasonal weather patterns that farmers depend on when they plant their crops. Millions of climate refugees are being displaced from their homes, and their production, their food production, upended. Farmers are having a hard time growing the food that they need for their local communities, let alone to be able to bring to local markets. We know that we have to stop this rising of global temperatures. We know this to be true. Climate scientists have warned us that a 2-degree rise in temperature will lead to catastrophic effects. We were going to see the Amazon drying up. We could see large portions of food production areas in Central America, in Africa, and Asia, and parts of the Southern and Pacific Oceans will become toxic to plankton and other organisms, creating marine deserts, and these will have large rippling effects. Policymakers are now talking about trying to keep temperatures from rising 2 degrees. But what we've heard, Fatih Birol, the chief economist of the International Energy Association, has said that the door to 2 degrees is closing soon. In 2017, it will close forever. And that's next year. We're not talking 50 or 100 years into the future. We're talking next year. But meanwhile, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is talking about a 4 to 5 degree rise in temperature over the next 80 years. This is what we are on course for if we don't change what we are doing. We also know that agriculture is a key contributor to climate change. It accounts for up to one-third of global greenhouse gas emissions. For example, deforesting the Amazon in order to intensify cattle or soybean production, or deforesting Indonesian land areas to put in place oil palm plantations for ethanol production. So these are not even producing food crops. One-third of global greenhouse gas emissions. That's significant. Our soil is worn out, we have to change course. Our water is contaminated, bees are dying. We're seeing a rise in childhood cancers and other health disorders associated with pesticide exposures. And all the while, the agriculture-related greenhouse gases of carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, and methane are increasing from these systems. But there's a very good story in this that I have for you tonight. It's this deeply hopeful story of change that is happening all around us, the story of agroecological transformation. We can reverse climate change, and we can nourish the world through an agroecological transformation of our food and farming systems. I'm going to talk to you about two things tonight: what agroecology is and why it matters, and what the democratization of our food system means and why that matters. Because the future of food and the future of our planet requires that we get these two things right. So what is agroecology? At its core, it's the study, design, co-creation, and management of sustainable farming systems, drawing on millennia of ancestral knowledge and continually evolving, integrating the innovations of farmers and ecological scientists. Agroecology is also a social movement that is led by small-scale producers around the world who are demanding a change to the power structures in society that are keeping so many people poor, hungry, and impoverished. And for many, agroecology is simply a way of life. It's a way of being within the world and with nature. So to make this real for you, I'm going to take you on a journey that goes from Mexico to Mozambique, China, and then back to the US to give you some sense of the very rich examples amongst thousands that are flourishing around the world of agroecology, cooling the planet, and nourishing the world. So our first stop is the cloud-forested mountains of Veracruz, Mexico. These lands, some 20 years ago, were highly degraded from cattle grazing. In this environment, Ricardo Romero saw what was happening and wanted to make a difference. He took the bold step of selling off all his cows and undertook an ambitious ecological restoration project. He planted 50,000 trees on 150 acres of land and left another 100 acres to regenerate naturally. And this system very quickly began to regenerate the soil that had been so degraded, build up soil organic matter, and capture carbon. So this story is a story also of climate mitigation, reversing climate. Plants can take atmospheric carbon and store or sequester it in the soil. And this is one of the most powerful ways we have of averting climate change. There's too much carbon dioxide that we have released into the atmosphere. We need to draw this carbon dioxide down. And one of the most powerful ways is through very diversified, complex agroforestry systems with perennial crops that capture that carbon, store it in the soil, and also store it, a lot of it, in the above-ground biomass, in the plant matter. So after some years of restoring the environment, Ricardo established this cooperative, Las Cañadas, with his neighbors. And they began integrating the organic, biointensive farming methods, drawing on principles of permaculture, along with the traditional Mexican milpa system, a polyculture of growing maize together with beans and soybeans. They also introduced cover cropping and contour cropping around the curves of the slopes of the fields. They planted bamboo, which is a powerful way to store a tremendous amount of carbon. And the bamboo also provides building materials. In fact, they are able to provide enough building materials for all the members of the co-op for 100 years. But probably the most powerful carbon sequestration that is happening, carbon storing that is happening on their farm, is in their bosque comestible, which is their edible forest. And this is a highly diversified system of perennial staple crops. So these are trees, vines, plants that provide fruits, nuts, edible oils, starches, vegetables, a wide range of crops that grow in a multi-layered, a multi-strata system. So this system is capturing carbon, it's rejuvenating the soil, it's providing building materials, energy, and food. Perhaps less tangible, but central to the co-op success, is also the cultural connections and the social relationships that form through this collective effort and action. The Las Cañadas story is featured, is highlighted in a new book called Carbon Farming by Eric Tonsmeyer. It just came out this year. It's a massive tome that provides rich layers of details of many, many kinds of farming systems, especially the perennial agroforestry systems. And he calls what Las Cañadas is doing as the gold standard, a perennial, very complex agroforestry systems that has the most power of capturing carbon. It can capture 10 to 40 times the amount of carbon that annual cropping systems can. So a powerful solution to climate change. So I mentioned that climate scientists have alerted us that there are 200 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide, of excess carbon dioxide that are in the atmosphere that we need to draw down if we are to avert climate disaster. We also, of course, need to stop the emissions that are ongoing from many other industries as well. But we can pull down a tremendous amount of that excess carbon dioxide through agroecological practices like those at Las Cañadas Cooperative. Tonsmeyer has done the math on this, done calculations, and estimates that agroecological practices, such as those undertaken by Las Cañadas, these rich perennial agroforestry systems, and other ways, more simple ways, of diversifying your farm, if done widely, had the potential to draw down over 350 billion tons of carbon dioxide. And that's a lot. And that's a lot to be hopeful for. Across the region, across Honduras, Guatemala, and Nicaragua, 10,000 people lost their lives. Over 3 million people were displaced, and the region experienced nearly $7 billion in damage. So agroecology not only can mitigate climate change and help move us out of the current trajectory we are on now, it is also resilient and productive. And it's very adaptive and flexible, giving farmers the capacity to withstand and recover from the kinds of pressures and stresses from climate change that we are already experiencing and have been for some time. In 1998, Hurricane Mitch swept across Central America, bringing gale force winds and dumping tremendous amounts of rain. After the storm, farmers and scientists who had been working together in the Campesino e Campesino program, the farmer-to-farmer program in that area, got together to assess the hurricane's impacts in the region. They conducted an enormous participatory assessment study, and they went out and examined 1,800 conventional and agroecological farms managed by some 15,000 farmers. And what they found was astounding. They found that the agroecological farmers had experienced far less erosion, maintained more vegetation, 20 to 40% more topsoil was retained on their farms, and they experienced far less economic losses than the conventional farmers right in their area. In Nicaragua, the agroecological farmers actually had a net profit even after the hurricane. And these farmers, so the conventional farmers were planting monocultures, but the agroecological farmers were doing, as you can see here, contour cropping, agroforestry, hedgerows, and other practices to build up the soil organic matter. All right, we're going to move now out of Latin America and travel some 10,000 miles to the village of Namacha in Mozambique. Now, historically, these communities in Mozambique have been using agroecological practices. They're part and parcel of the culture and social life of the communities. But as industrial agricultural production has risen in Swaziland, neighboring Swaziland and South Africa, the Mozambicans have been importing more food from those countries, much of it highly contaminated with pesticides. In order to restore and rebuild community self-reliance and reinvigorate local production, the Mozambican Farmers Union, UNAC, began to reintroduce agroecological practices. And women have been in the forefront of many of these initiatives. This one particular group is a widows group, a group of widows who got together to help each other in their farming activities. They were looking for ways to save money, increase production, and gain some profit. And what they found was the ecological methods were really the best path forwards for them. So they began adopting practices such as mulching with hay to suppress weeds and retain soil moisture, integrating compost and manure from their cows, and diversifying their production. They began growing many more kinds of fruits and vegetables than they had in the past, and their systems thrived. Now, having done so well at home, on their own farms, they turned their attention to the larger political and economic systems that were threatening their livelihoods. One of the biggest threats to family farmers in Mozambique is the surge of land grabs that have been taking place across the country. So the state owns the land in Mozambique, and the government has been issuing these 50-year concessions to foreign companies with the option to renew for another 50 years. These companies come in, displace the peasant farmers, and then start planting timber, soybean, sugarcane, maize, all for industrial export markets. So these companies, what they're doing is not feeding the world, they're pushing the farmers off the land. And so the women's groups have been gathering regularly in assemblies now to identify the problem, to strategize, and to push back against these land grabs. They've joined up with the regional Southern Rural Women's Assembly of Southern Africa. And they've been joining those assemblies, and together have been figuring out how to organize protests and marches to tell the government to stop with the land grabs, and to listen to them, and to respect their rights to land, to seeds, to livelihood, and to culture. They've also, on their own, decided, well, we can't wait for the government and the timber companies to move out of the way, so we're also going to recover our own native seed systems. And so they've begun their own projects of saving and exchanging seed. Moving now, another 5,000 miles over to Yunnan, China. This is the traditional system of rice, duck, fish, and frog farming that women in particular have been cultivating. This system, it's a very beautiful system that has many layers of ecological function. The ducks, through their pecking and treading in the fields, reduce disease. They open up the rice canopy that reduces the humidity. There's less disease. They're also eating the snails and the weeds. Snails are a big pest there, and the weeds and the insect pests, stem borers and others. And so weed populations have dropped by 70 to 80%. Insect pest populations have dropped also from 70 to 95%. With that taken care of, there's no need for pesticides. And with the pesticides gone, the fish and the frogs come back and have been thriving. And these provide, of course, protein and add crucial dietary diversity to the families of these women. In other parts of Asia, farmers and scientists are getting together now and experimenting with the introduction of azolla, which is an aquatic fern that fixes nitrogen, and that can further boost yields. The azolla, tiny little fern plants, cover the water, and that cools the temperature in the water, which is good for the fish, but also reduces the methane emissions from the rice fields. And that's very important. Methane is a greenhouse gas, and the emissions in conventional rice production systems have been very high. On an economic level, the women who are raising these ducks, doing the rice duck fish farming, on average have attained a $300 advantage, $300 more in profit per hectare than the conventional rice farmers. And that is a lot for these women. But in Guangdong province, where these rice duck farmers have been utilizing organic methods, they receive thousands of dollars more. Over $6,000 more, actually, is quite significant than the conventional farmers because of the premium that organic rice fetches. So, again, productive, profitable, ecologically robust and resilient, and climate friendly. Okay, now we come back to the US. Carmen Fernholz is a corn farmer in Minnesota. On his farm, he grows corn and soybeans organically, and he's been able to show that ecological methods of corn production are possible in the Midwest. He integrates with flax and alfalfa and has other ways of diversifying the system, including land diversification around his farm. Carmen has been farming for over 4 decades in this area successfully. And he has weathered, with his organic corn, soybean, and complex rotations, he has weathered commodity price swings and bouts of bad weather. He's come through all this very well, and he told us with some pride recently that a neighbor and a conventional farm came by, had been watching what he was doing on his farm, and then came and asked him for his help in how to transition from conventional pesticide-dependent corn production over to the ecological methods that Carmen was doing in Minnesota. We also have diversified fruit and vegetable production in California. This is Paul Kaiser of Singing Frog's Farm up north. And Singing Frog's Farm has achieved the most tremendous amounts of soil organic matter, 5 to 6% soil organic matter, which if you follow soil organic matter stuff, that's really high, that's really good. And he's accomplished this through a combination of no-till, cover cropping, composting, integrating animals in his system. He also has planted thousands of native perennials in hedgerows to protect bees and other pollinators, which, again, for Californians, we are seeing these tremendous losses of our bee populations, much of it linked to neonicotinoid pesticides. So what Paul Kaiser is doing is a huge service to all of us as well. What it does with the alfalfa is the roots go down deep into the soil and they're left there. And when they decompose and they break down, that opens up these fabulous tunnels for the water to percolate down. And then we have organic dairy production in Vermont, the Chouinier family farm. And on this farm, they are growing organic crops to feed their cows. And they have, again, intercropping alfalfa and deep-rooted radish. So they are addressing soil compaction, enabling air and water to permeate into the soil, building up soil organic matter, which also enables the land to retain more moisture and water. And these qualities, both these qualities, the permeation and the soil, the moisture holding qualities, are really important both in times of drought and flood. And then we have urban farms and community gardens around the country, where youth, many times youth are in the forefront, are managing these farms, and are in the forefront of creating new models of just and healthy food systems. Also, farm workers are organizing and creating their own community gardens. The Farm Worker Association of Florida is doing just that, and has a number of community gardens that is enabling the farm workers to reconnect with their land and their cultures, and farm to provide healthy food to their communities. The Farm Workers Association of Florida and Rural Coalition recently organized an agroecology encuentro, or gathering, in which they provided training to family farmers and farm workers from around the country in agroecological practices, as well as workshops in understanding the broader political and economic structures that are in place and that are impinging on their ability to have sustainable food systems. So there's a lot happening in the U.S. as well. Here too, agroecology works. This is what Olivier de Schutter, as UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food, said a few years ago. To feed 9 billion people in 2050, we urgently need to adopt the most efficient farming techniques available. Agroecology, done right, can produce just as much food while conserving natural resources and improving ecological resistance. And numerous UN reports and independent studies have come to the same conclusion. You don't need to copy down or study or look at all of these. I just put up a few examples of the latest reports from UN agencies. The last one, this UN study, looked at 114 projects in 24 African countries. And they found that where agroecological practices had been adopted, yield more than doubled. Okay, so if agroecology is so great, why isn't it everywhere? Well, it actually is. As you've seen, it is happening all over the world, but you probably haven't been hearing a lot about it. Let me ask you if anyone here has read a story on agroecology in a major newspaper. No. Well, that's not surprising. And we have some data to help us understand that it's not just that we missed that story. Gaetan van Loeckeren did a study. He looked at the New York Times. And he reviewed all the New York Times material from 1981 to 2008. He found that in this period of time, the New York Times mentioned, there was a mention of genetic engineering 3,000 times, but agroecology was mentioned 3 times. Okay, more recently, Anna LaPay did a similar study just some months ago, and she looked at the New York Times coverage from 1980 until today, so a 35, 36-year period. And in this period of time, the New York Times mentioned agroecology only 14 times. Only one of these stories was a study that actually discussed agriculture and agroecology. It was a story about pesticides in India, where agroecology was brought forward as the solution. But the other examples, one was in an obituary, one was a letter to the editor, one was in the vows column. There were several references to agroecology in the titles of departments. And then there were 4 mentions or 4 discussions of agroecology in opinion pieces that were all written by Mark Bittman, who will be speaking at the symposium tomorrow. So it's important to realize that media not only provides information and reflects what's happening out there, but it shapes our understanding of the world. It shapes our opinions. And so that's one reason why in the US the conversation, the public conversation about agroecology has been so muted. There are a number of reasons also why agroecology is limited. It's growing. It certainly, as a movement, is growing around the world. And we're seeing that agroecology is proving its capacity to nourish communities and to mitigate climate change. But the reality is that the model of industrialized agriculture still dominates the market. And this has very much to do with the political and economic agendas of the most powerful actors on the global food stage, namely the agribusiness corporations and the government institutions that they influence. And so this brings me to the second part of my talk, why democracy matters. Because in order to overcome the obstacles that are arrayed out there that family farmers and peasant farmers are facing, we're going to need to build a really powerful grassroots movement in order to see that we can that implement an agroecological transformation at the global scale. So here's the problem, or at least part of the problem. Over the past decade, 15 years, we've seen an unprecedented wave of corporate consolidation in the agribusiness industry, corporate concentration, companies buying up other companies. And we're seeing this in the chemical and seed sector all the way through to the global, to the grocery retail sector. So this shows you what's happening in the seed sector, what has happened over the past 20 years. We had 200 independent small-scale seed suppliers 20 years ago. Most of them have been bought up by the big 6 pesticide seed companies, Monsanto, namely, as well as Dow and DuPont, Syngenta, BASF, and Bayer. The top 3 pesticide companies control over half of the world's global seed supply. Monsanto is in the lead. Of all of this, Monsanto alone controls 1/4 of the commercial seed market. That's a problem. It's a problem for family farmers. That's a problem for all of us. And it's not just about seeds. Seeds are critically important. And without seeds, farmers aren't going to be able to do the agroecology that we've been talking about. Seeds are the foundation of farmers' resilience and the way that for millennia farmers have developed and adapted and modified their systems, creating and evolving to really have the kinds of farming systems that are best suited to their locale. But it's not just about seeds. This is what Monsanto said. What you're seeing is not just a consolidation of seed companies. It's really a consolidation of the entire food chain. So this consolidation of market share translates directly into political power and influence over government agencies and over policymaking processes. And I'll give you a few examples of how this actually plays out. Lobbying. In one 10-year period, 50 of the biggest biotech and chemical industries spent over $500 million lobbying Congress. They were lobbying to ensure that We have weak, lax biotech regulations that was accomplished in the 90s. And to ensure that we continue to have the kind of farm policies that keep us wedded to this chemical-intensive extractive model of industrial agriculture that is putting out greenhouse gas emissions and driving family farmers out of business. Also, illegal intervention in public policy processes. Some years ago, Monsanto was fined for bribing Indonesian government officials in order to be able to get their GMO seeds approved and planted in that country. They were fined $1.5 million. More recently, a colleague of mine from Pesticide Action Network was at an international pesticide treaty conference of the Rotterdam Convention. And there, she observed an industry consultant masquerading as a government delegate on the Guatemalan government delegation. He was speaking for the Guatemalan government. Another PAN colleague from Mexico discovered who he really was, and when this information came out, the chair of the meeting, stripped him of his credentials and threw him out of the meeting. The right thing to do. And this just happened to be one example where we found out what was going on. But this kind of thing happens all the time. The USDA has been charged with suppressing the science, its own scientists' findings around pesticides, especially around the impacts of pesticides on pollinators and on bees. So all these kinds of things continue to happen. Globally, I've mentioned the land grabs. So corporations' ability to grab up land and privatize water and gain access to these critical resources is another way that their connection with governments have put farmers on the defensive and pushed farmers off the land. And then we also have corporations expanding their control over seeds. As if they didn't have enough control already, they've been expanding it by pushing governments into the adoption of intellectual property regimes that transfer ownership of seed to the corporations and then criminalize farmers for saving and exchanging seed. Another example of how corporations have taken over the public agenda, it is also happening in our universities, where universities have experienced a drying up of public funds. Corporations have stepped in some cases have been able to get onto committees deciding where grants go to graduate students and so on. Tremendous amount of money going into biotech, development of seeds that can be patented and bring universities benefits from those patents. Very little is going into agroecological research. And so we have this problem of corporate influence over public research agendas. The Union of Concerned Scientists looked at USDA funding and found that the USDA gives less than 15% of its research and education grants to agroecology. With an overall budget of $157 billion, just $12 million is going to projects that are advancing transformative agroecology. So that brings us back to this problem of how do we reclaim control of our seeds, our food, our land, and democratize the food system? What does democratizing the food system look like? Here are some examples, but I will give you a few more in detail to show you how people around the world are taking back control of their food systems, and this is really part and parcel of agroecology. The Tamil Nadu Women's Collective in India. This is a story not only of personal empowerment of women, but of empowerment of communities that have been able to make change at the local level. The Tamil Nadu Women's Collective was established some 20 years ago around three principles: gender justice, women's leadership in local governance, and natural farming. Their first campaign was focused on addressing violence against women. And so they began providing workshops, they provided shelters to women, legal counseling, and also training and workshops with men and women together so that there could be a shared understanding of women's role and rights in the community, in the household. So as they continued these workshops, they also moved on to the next level of expanding and empowering women in governance. They had an explicit goal of increasing women's participation in local governments. And they did this as well. They made use of a law in India that one-third of local office must be held by women. So in the first year that they began tackling this issue and putting women forward, in 1996, they ran about 200 women for office. 100 women were elected. 5 years later, in 2001, they ran 400 women from the collective ran for office, and over 200 were elected. 5 years later, in 2006, 900 women ran for office, and 400 were elected. 78 of these women were actually elected as president of their panchayat, their local government. From these positions of leadership, then, the women were able to have conversations with their communities about the ecological and agricultural issues of their time. From their own assessment of the ecological and agrarian crisis happening in Tamil Nadu, they came to the conclusion in conversation with their communities that they needed to take a path towards natural farming, which is what we've been calling agroecology all along. So as you've been hearing, they diversified their farms. They began bringing back local millets and pulses, bringing in many vegetables and fruits. But also, really importantly, was the political engagement that they took with the system. It was really important for them, for the women, to have land titles. So they had a campaign, they fought long and hard, and they actually won land titles. And as the women said, the women of the Tamil Nadu Women's Collective, land is critical for women. It's part of it provides us with personal security, as well as community security, and the ecological security to be able to transform the land and feed our communities. Another example I want to share with you is from right here in the US, because women farmers in the US are also recognizing that they need to engage in democratic processes to be able to get the money out of politics and take back, reorient our agricultural policies to really meet the needs of family farmers in this country. The Women, Food, and Agriculture Network was founded by Denise O'Brien. I was talking with Denise some months ago. We were actually talking about the living soils. She farms in Iowa. She's the owner of Rolling Acres Farm. And we were talking about the living soils and the problem of widespread degradation of soil across the Midwest. And I asked her, what is the most important thing to do to help Midwest farmers with their soils? She said three words. She said, campaign finance reform. Get the money out of politics. Get the corporations out of the USDA and out of government. So I thought that was very telling. And her vision was to bring women together to increase women's leadership in policymaking processes. And so for that, she has dedicated her life. And she said, the purpose of my life is to empower women in agricultural policy making in this way, by putting women back on the land, giving women the power to make decisions and affect our policy, I think we'll be able to move forward out of the crisis that much of US agriculture is in. And at a global level, global social movements are organizing around agroecology. La Via Campesina, which represents some 200 million farmers, and other alliances have been organizing around principles of food sovereignty. And food sovereignty is the right, has been defined as the right of peoples to healthy and culturally appropriate food, the right of family farmers and peasant farmers to define their own food and agricultural systems. And food sovereignty movements, there are local, national, regional, and international movements around food sovereignty. They have been lifting up agroecology as a central pillar. Because for food sovereignty to succeed, we need agroecology. For agroecology to succeed, we need farmers to have control over their land, over their seeds and water. Last year, delegates of small family organizations and producers, fisher folk, workers, indigenous peoples, gathered in Nyalini, Mali to have the first international forum on agroecology. And I think the best way for me to share what they were saying by giving you a chance to hear some of their voices. So this is a short clip.
Thank you. in our own language, we call it kurima kwechinyakare, meaning our traditional agriculture. That describes that what we inherited from our parents, which has sustained our parents, our environment for generations.
La visión del Maela es que la agroecología es el gran paraguas político de todas las agro e hidroculturas que los productores de alimentos a pequeña escala hacemos en el mundo, en los distintos territorios. Tiene el desafío de que es una propuesta de modelo alternativo a este sistema, pero que no homogeneiza lo que hacemos en los territorios, sino que se rige bajo principios en común, principios productivos, biológicos, sociales, políticos.
We kind of see it as food sovereignty. So when we say food sovereignty, that means that each community has the sovereignty, the autonomy to choose how we want to do it, what we want to grow, you know, what way of life we want to choose.
La agroecología es importante también porque puede garantizar la sostenibilidad de la biodiversidad, que para nosotros la biodiversidad es el principio y el fin de la vida y de las culturas, de los pueblos.
Quand on parle d'agroécologie, c'est quelque chose qui lie l'agriculture paysanne avec les connaissances des ancêtres, ensuite les recherches scientifiques. Donc on doit combiner ça.
So I see agroecology as a vehicle through which truly sustainable food production and ways for us to connect with the land in general, and can happen in a way that's really owned by the populace, in a way that doesn't just create a new market, but that in a way that's allowing us to access affordable food for each other, providing good income for the producers, and goes beyond, hopefully goes beyond the idea of just singular farms, you know, and more collective action.
All right, so I have one last point that I want to share with you. And that is about, back to our topic of public science and research. So if public science and research agendas have been captured by corporations, as they largely have, where does that leave us? What can we do? How can we democratize the governance of our public research agendas and ensure that they are not being crafted and developed by corporate interests, but are rather reflecting the priorities of the small-scale farmers and peasant farmers whose needs we most need to address. But meanwhile, I want to tell you about this story of democratizing knowledge systems. It's a really exciting work of the Rural Workers Association of Nicaragua. Last week, I had the opportunity to meet with Marlene Sanchez. She's this group's national coordinator of agroecology. And she first explained to me that the Association of Rural Workers of Nicaragua was established in 1978 to support the rights of workers as well as family farmers in Nicaragua. She also told us how she had early training in agroecology, and that this then inspired her to move on to work with others and develop an international network of schools of agroecology across Latin America. She is now in the process of building a Mesoamerican regional peasant agroecology university, which is very exciting. And these schools are designed to provide agroecological training specifically for peasant farmers. They not only provide training in the practices of agroecology, but also political education around issues of globalization and industrial agriculture and climate change. I was also really moved by Marlene's description of the need for diálogo de saberes, or dialogues of knowing, dialogues of knowledge systems, ways in which we can support, learn from, and listen to each other, open and transparent and respectful dialogues, in which we can share the different ways of knowing that we as different communities of people have. It is through these dialogues that many agroecological innovations emerge, through the creative process of co-learning between different peoples. And so if you're engaging, after engaging these discussions, I'd like to invite you to to think about these questions and also as you move forward in your own work. How will you democratize your research agenda? How will you help roll back corporate control and build democracy in the food system, whether in your local system or globally? And how will you support an agroecological transformation of the food and farming system? There is much that we here can do in the United States to support the courageous women and men that are leading agroecology, food sovereignty, and climate justice movements around the world, as well as right here in the United States. In supporting these movements, in contributing our own capacities in whatever ways we can, and bringing our own ways of being and knowing to these conversations, we can make a difference. I believe that we can roll back corporate control and reverse climate change and tackle poverty and health and the inequities in our food system by getting to its underlying roots. It will take courage and curiosity and humility, but I believe that together we can bring deep democracy and an agroecological transformation to our food and farming systems. Thank you.